Hello, hope you're enjoying Learn World so far. And now we're going to talk about sticky knowledge. So what do I mean by sticky knowledge? Well, I train a lot of people and it's something that I didn't mean to get into. And in fact, my parents, the one profession they told me never to get into was teaching. But the thing is, I've spent my career working in all sorts of things relating to content. So I started out working in radio, and then I moved to working in digital. So I've worked with people like the BBC, ITV, AOL, Yahoo. That's where I crafted my early career before founding a digital marketing agency, Sookio, based in Cambridge, in 2008. And people keep on asking me to share my expertise. So whether it's in workshops and training, so we train people like the government in the UK or Cambridge University, people in comms teams there, or my series of online courses in digital marketing, Sookio School, then whether it's these types of formats or all the webinars that we've put out over the whole awful pandemic period, then what I'm trying to do is make sure that we share information in a way that's easy for people to understand, but also so they retain it long after. And so the reason my parents didn't want me to go into teaching was because they were both teachers and found it quite stressful themselves. But I clearly remember this moment when I was a little girl and I was out shopping with my mum, and someone came up to her and just said thank you. And she was a primary school teacher teaching music, and she had developed her own system of helping people learn music through colour coding. So C was orange and D was brown, that kind of thing. And it had a really lasting impact. And I get a similar feeling nowadays when people come up to me and say, thank you so much, that tip that I learned from you in a workshop 5 years ago, I'm still using it now, and it helps me do my social media better, or it helps me with my website copy, all of these things. And it's really nice. So this is what I wanted to talk about today. And I'm going to start off by talking about some of the things that you can do before your workshop begins or your webinar or ahead of the course that people take. And then lots of ideas for what you can do during the sessions to make sure that the information is easy for people to understand, so it really sinks in while they're there. And then we'll look at what goes on after the event, because a lot of people, when they're putting a course together, feel like, okay, that's it, done, yep, over. But actually, there's lots of things that you can do afterwards to really help the information stick. So I'm going to tell you three things that you can do to get people really engaged ahead of your course or workshop or webinar, whatever it is. And the first thing I like to do is set a task. So if I'm, for example, doing a workshop on writing for the web, then I get people to really think about the copy that they struggle with. So maybe look at their website and come prepared with a particular page that they think needs a bit of work. And then we can build it into an activity during the session. Or I'm running a social media workshop next week, and I've already told everybody it's for small local retailers to have a look around their town at other people running shops and cafes and all this kind of thing, and pick out some examples of people that they know are already doing it well. And the second thing is to do your research. So you've got such an opportunity here to find out more about the attendees. I always like to show best practice examples because that helps everything sink in. And I'll tell you a bit more about this shortly. But if you can find out who's going to be in the room on the day and use some of their work as a best practice example, then they'll really love you for it. And it means that you're making connection with them. And you can also find out more about competitors. So if you're going to pick a bad example of people doing something wrong, then why not pick a competitor? And everybody will have a good laugh about it on the day. But it's this kind of research that means that you're well prepared and ready to make a connection with people in the room. And the third thing you can do ahead of the session is help people become mentally prepared for what they're about to learn. So if it's a face-to-face workshop, I like to circulate an outline so people know the structure, they know what they're going to get. Or if it's an online course, then make sure that you really fill in the description that comes with it that says to people, yep, this is what you're going to learn. So this means they're not coming to it cold. They're ready, they're engaged, and they want to know what you're about to say. So in summary, three things that you can do beforehand to make sure that people are really engaged and ready to learn. First of all, set a task so they're thinking about your session or course ahead of time. And then do your research so you know more about competitors and who's going to be in the room, anything that enables you to make a connection. And then lastly, make sure that people know what they're going to get. So help them become mentally prepared by circulating an outline or giving a good description of the course in the text. Going to think about all those things that you can do during the course or during the program, during the workshop, to help people really understand the information. Now, point one is get a bloody move on. We've all been on those Zoom calls where, oh my goodness, they go around every single person and say, can you please introduce yourself and say what you do and talk a little bit, and people put themselves on mute accidentally and it's all awful. There was one the other day, I just felt like jumping out the window. 20 minutes in, we're only halfway through. So the very most important thing you can do is just get moving, get cracking. And then secondly, I like to give people something to do early on. And this is really important because it makes people feel really engaged, like it's not just going to be a one-way broadcast where they just kind of sit there in this passive way. And so things that you can do would be, say, if it's a webinar, I really like to have a poll early on, something super easy and simple that people can answer straight away. They don't have to put too much thought to it. Or what I might do in a training session around creating content is say to people, right, don't move, but just grab something within arm's reach and make it interesting, or take a photo of it, or do something with it. So it's something that is really achievable, doesn't take too much thought, doesn't take too much work, but they can do it straight away. And I think it's important, once you've had that initial activity, to keep them up all the way through. And this is the third point. Making your workshops and your sessions interactive is really important. And in a way, it doesn't matter what the format is. Making sure that it's not just you talking all the way through, just droning on, then that is really important. And it helps people really take the information in. And it also creates an environment where they can ask questions and look at things in a different perspective. So I like to give people something they can do with their hands. Can they look away and draw something or scribble something? And if it's a face-to-face workshop, if you're in that dreaded after lunch spot where people have had their lunch and they're feeling a bit drowsy, I love doing some sort of activity where I make everybody get up, go to the other side of the room, they go in groups, they mix with people they haven't spoken to so far. And you might do something where they move post-it notes around, you know, that involves bending over and holding things up and looking at them. Anything that gets people moving and active really helps the information go in, because it's keeping their brain engaged, and you're shifting the way they're receiving the information all the time. And the fourth thing is about show, not tell. So you can quite easily tell people information on and on and on, but until you put something visual next to it, it doesn't really sink in. And we process things visually in a different way to how we do it verbally, or how we read the words on the page. So I'm always giving people best practice examples. There's no point me saying, okay, well, if you put more punctuation in a tweet, then that makes it more likely to be shared and retweeted. Or if I say, can you make your social media content more visual, because that gets higher levels of engagement, then people will nod and smile and go, yeah, no, that sounds great. But until I actually show it to them, then it's not going to sink in quite the same way. So as I was saying in the section before this, it's really important to do your research. This is where it really comes into being, because if you can pull out examples that really, really demonstrate what you're saying, then it will sink in much more effectively. And if you think yourself, when you're doing an online course or you're in a workshop, just think about those times when you've really learned something, you know, those penny dropping moments. And often for me, it's when I really demonstrate an example, like a before and an after. So I talk a lot about writing for the web. And again, people will say, yeah, more line breaks, more bullet points, more subheadings. Yeah, brilliant, love it. But it's not until I actually say, right, here's a bit of copy that is written really badly, and say to people, well, why? Why is that badly? What's so not good about it? I get them to actually try and fix it themselves, and then we can talk about the activity and who's done it particularly well, and then I can show them an example. So that idea, mixing those two things together, doing the activity and showing people good examples, is a really effective approach. Now, if you're preparing slides to go with your course, then I cannot stress this enough, try and keep the text light. And I mean, I was at a tech conference recently and I felt like storming the stage. Honestly, they couldn't have crammed more into each slide. It was awful. So many charts and graphics and tiny, tiny bits of text and arrows pointing here. Just too much to take in. And if you're looking at the slide and trying to read what it says and focusing on that, then you're not listening to what the person is saying at all. So really, really try and strip it back. It's really nice to just be able to have an image and talk around it if possible. You know, no one's saying that you have to have loads and loads of text on the screen. So really think again, think about presentations, courses, whatever that you've been to, where it's really gone in. And it's probably been because the speaker is so engaging. And as a speaker or trainer yourself, if you have to rely on all the information being on the slides, then you probably don't explain it well enough, or you don't understand it well enough to be able to explain it well enough. Then you really want to try and strip things back. Lots of white space, fewer than 10 words per slide if possible. Just keep it really light and simple. And lastly, when we're thinking about how to make the information really sink in, it's an oldie but a goodie, this one. So tell people what they're about to learn. Tell them what they're learning while they're learning it. So do lots of recaps. And then tell them what they've just learned. So summarise at the end. And because I like to put my money where my mouth is, this is the approach I've taken in this short talk. So in the opening summary, I said, this is how the talk is structured. This is what we're going to be talking about. And then while talking, I've been reiterating what we're talking about. So I've been saying, this is the section where we're talking about helping information sink in. And then guess what? Right now, I'm going to do a summary. So if you want the information to really sink in, what I would suggest is, number one, get a bloody move on. Number two, give people something to do straight away, and preferably something relatively easy and achievable. Next, you want to break it up with lots of activities and show, not tell. So don't just tell people things. Give them visual examples to really, really help them process the information. Keep the text really light. So don't go cramming 500 words and charts and infographics onto each slide. And lastly, tell people what they're about to learn, what they're learning, and what they've just learned. So what about when it all comes to an end? What your goal is here is for people to retain the information, because you've spent all that time creating the course or developing your workshop. And so what's the point if people don't remember what you've taught them? You really, really want it to stick. So I've got three more tips for you here. And the first thing is to capture their commitments. So if it's face-to-face, then I like to say to people, right, what three things are you going to put into action this afternoon or tomorrow, this week, next month? Write these down and send them to me and I'll share them with everybody and try and keep you accountable. Otherwise, it's just this kind of fog of really great stuff they've just learned, but they haven't really made concrete plans for what they're actually going to do with this information. And then the next thing is about setting homework. So remember, we want to set a task before they turn up. You want to continue this on and set them homework after the event. And it could be something as simple, say if I'm doing a LinkedIn workshop, I want people to send me a connection request and I'll have taught them all about etiquette. So I want them to word it really nicely as well. So that kind of thing. Or in my social media workshop next week, I'm going to get people to connect with other local businesses and do a tweet about them, share some of their content, all of these kind of things. So set this task and make sure that people have to take action. Otherwise, they'll go back to their inboxes, or they'll go for a meeting, or they've got to pick the kids up, all these kind of things. And quickly, this information, it leaks away. So you have to get them to take action really quickly. So it really, really sinks in, they retain it. And then the last thing is plan to check in. And this really helps keep people accountable. So maybe a week after your session, then say that you'll have a call and then people can really talk through, okay, so they had a big ambition to do this particular thing, but then they found they struggled with, I don't know, social media logins or something like that. Or there was some kind of obstacle they came up against. And then this means they can just make a note and then they can talk to you about it. And it also means that if you've captured their commitments, you can say, well, have you done this? And so because they know that they've got this call with you coming up, then they know, oh, hang on, I better make sure I do these things that this crazy person told me to. And then even if it's not a face-to-face session, then, and it's just it's an online course, and I know lots of people watching this, you make online courses, so this is really important. Then having some kind of private area like a forum, a Facebook group can be really great. Then this again helps people check in. So maybe the task that you set is around an illustration or creating a blog, getting their first post written, that kind of thing. You can encourage them at the end of your course to post about it in this forum. And then it's great because other people will also give feedback, and it should be constructive and positive and helpful. So then the load isn't all on you. And it just gives this continuity. It means that everything is carrying through. So in summary, here are the things that you can do to help people really retain the information. First of all, capture their commitments. Set them some homework so they really have to put things into action straight away. And then lastly, plan to check in so you're holding them accountable. I hope you found this talk interesting and useful, and that you've taken lots of tips from it that will help your own knowledge become more sticky in future. And so a little bit of homework for you. Can you think about an activity that will help people become hooked and engaged right from the beginning? And then the kind of homework that you could set that will help them retain the information long afterwards. And I hope you've enjoyed the LearnWorlds Summit, and there's lots of other talks going on. So do explore all of these. And if you want to connect with me, then I'm at Sookio, S-O-O-K-I-O, on social media, and you'll find me on every platform going. So do connect and ask any questions. Thank you.